Now let's try that. Is that better? Okay. Let's open in a word of prayer. We need to pray for several people who are out ill, and then I'm going to ask that we pray and do something a little bit different this morning. I was very upset and angry yesterday when I seen something, and not angry physically or anything like that. I was angry spiritually, and I'll explain what that is in just a moment. So let's open in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come together. We thank you, Lord, that you are real, that you are alive, that you are living. And Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we just give you praise and glory. Lord, we come into your presence with thanksgiving. Lord, we open up our hearts, Lord, with joy, Lord, before you, that we can worship you and praise you and magnify you. And Lord, right now, let your glory fill this place. Lord, let it fill every person, Lord, that is here this morning and listening by video. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, that our hearts would be stirred, and Lord, that you would be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Amen? And as we pray for folks, Donna's out ill this morning with allergies, and a few others are out. But also, I want to pray something. It's time that the church took up their banner and start being the church. Amen? Yesterday, I was given a video that bothered me, and the first thing I was incensed and angry, and the Lord said, don't get angry. Begin to come against it. I don't know if you know what's going on in Portland or not, but not last night, but the night before last night, they had a Bible burning party, and they were burning Bibles in the street, and they were coming against Christianity, and they were coming against the presence of God. Some people have likened it to Nineveh. And so we need to begin to pray against the things that the devil is coming up with, and we need to begin to make a counterattack in the spiritual realm to defeat this thing. Amen? Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord, for all those who are sick, for all those who are ill. And Father, right now, we just give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. And Lord, as we open up our hearts and as we open up, Lord, to you this morning, right now we pronounce Jehovah Rapha over all those who are ill. Lord, all those who this week I have heard of that have been engaged in the battle against this COVID virus. Lord, all those who are ill because of allergies or whatever it might be. And Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I pronounce over them Jehovah Rapha, the Lord is our healer. And Father, I pronounce, Lord, a hedge of protection upon your people, the church, this morning. Lord, that as the devil would try to destroy, Lord, you would use it for the church to rise up and do something magnificent, marvelous, and miraculous. And Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we come against, Lord, the attitude, Lord, of Satan that would burn Bibles, that would burn the Word of God. And Lord, right now, we come against the evil. We come against, Lord, the satanic attack. And we raise up a standard against it. And Lord, we come and we pray for repentance in this country. We pray, Lord, that your spirit would take hold of the believers who would begin to stand up in faith and, Lord, walk in what you would have them walk in. Lord, that our hearts would be stirred to be more like you. And Father, in Jesus' name, I give you glory, honor, and praise. Lord, we know that you reign on high, and we, Lord, stand with a living and active God. And Lord, we know the reason why the attack against the word is because it is living and active. And Lord, right now, let that attitude come within us as believers, and let the word become living and active in us so that we can come against and stand against the wiles of the enemy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I do not apologize for praying this way. I do not apologize for coming against. I'm usually pretty non-committal politically here. And this is not a political thing. This is a spiritual thing. Understand that. Understand it is a spiritual thing. It has nothing to do with anything but the devil beginning to try to take advantage of situations in our country. And we need to stand up against it and say, in God we trust. Amen. Sing with me this morning as we sing a few songs. Better is one day in your house than thousands elsewhere.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, my soul. One thing.
everywhere, and we praise you, and we magnify you, that we have the opportunity this morning to say, better is one day. Hallelujah.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. A thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. A thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day.
Hallelujah. 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 If you're in your courts, then you can say, Lord, reign in me. Amen.
Rain in me, rain in me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And for Him to reign, we need to give Him our hearts. Lord, I give You my heart. I give You my soul. Hallelujah. This is my desire, to honor You. Is it your desire this morning to honor the Lord, who He is and what He wants to do within you? Hallelujah.
This is my desire to honor You, Lord, with all my heart, I worship You.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise. Tell him this morning you need him. Let him know, I need you more.
I need you more.
More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more. More than ever before, I need you more. In my life, I need you more. Your presence. Lord, cause us to hear. Lord, cause us to know. Lord, cause us to walk in your presence and in everything that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. I mean, you know, Jesus is real. I had intended to begin a series on the prodigal son this morning, but the Lord spoke to me last night and said, I want you to take one step back. And I said, well, okay, what do you mean, Lord? And I'm going to go by and this morning speak to you from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. And some of the scripture will be familiar to you because we've spoke on it a little bit before, but I want to speak on it in a little different perspective. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. And actually, we'll be going a little bit further than that, but we're going to start with those verses. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16 says this, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourself to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is so precious. It's so real. Father, right now, we just give you glory. Cause us, Lord, to gird up the loins of our mind. Cause us, Lord, to know more about you. Cause us to understand who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I want to begin this morning with a little story. How many of you, when you were teenagers, did something like this? Now, I'm a city boy, and at my high school, behind the football field, there was a railroad track. And one of the things that we used to do when we got bored is we would go up to the railroad track and put our ear to the rail to hear if the train was coming. Anybody done that before? Okay, there's one or two of you that have done it. And as you put your ear to the railroad track, long before you knew it was coming, you could hear through the vibration of the rail the train coming. Church, it's time for us spiritually to put our ear to the rail of the climate of the world so that we can know when the attacks of the enemy are coming and beware so that we can begin to pray against it. Peter begins by saying here, gird up the loins of your mind. Listen, put your ear to the rail. And he says two things about that. The first thing is be sober. Be sober. Pay attention. How many of you have ever listened to somebody and not paid attention to them? I began to look at that and I said, oh, Lord, what are you saying? He's saying a lot of my church is listening to my word but not paying attention to it. Be sober. Understand the seriousness of the presence of God. It's a serious thing. And the second thing he says is rest your hope upon the grace of Jesus. And as I begin to look at that, I begin to think of what we've been talking about the attitude of hope becoming faith, the mustard seed, and it growing up. Some of us need to understand that we've had hope that's been dormant for a long time, and we need to begin to water that hope so it becomes faith, so it becomes that grain of mustard seed. That small little thing becomes massive within our life and where Jesus is moving. Let me give you another illustration of this, and I like this, so I put it down. Peter's words in 1:13 are equivalent to saying this, roll up your sleeves and get to work. I remember being young and having chores. And I remember complaining about those chores and complaining about those chores. And one day, my dad looking at me and he said, if you would just go out and do the chores as much as you complain about the chores, that the chores would be done before you quit complaining. Hear me, church. God is saying it's time for us to roll up our sleeves and get to work. Quit complaining, well, God's not blessing me, or I don't have this, or I don't have that. Begin to say, I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. Begin to say, I can. Begin to say, God is not a God of failure, but He is a God of truth, and He will move me on. And as I begin to look at that, He mentioned that the return of Jesus Christ was to give them hope and stability in the face of persecution. We are coming into a day where the church is going to finally see in the United States of America persecution. We need to get ready. We need to understand that what is happening spiritually in our country is the beginning of a war for our country. Not just our country, but the spiritual health of our country. I'm not looking at these things in a physical mode. I'm looking at these things in a spiritual mode. It's time that we called this country, this church, and even ourselves to repentance. It's time that we come to a point where we understand that we should show our response to God's holiness by leaving evil desires of past ignorance. Holding on to things that are not quite right, and holding on to things that would make us compromise the Spirit of God in our life. And let's face it, we all do that. We have to understand that we can't do that anymore. We have to adopt God's own behavior as our pattern. Jesus, in one portion of Scripture, and this is not in your notes for those of you who have it, said, I give you the spirit of adoption. You have been adopted by God. You are His Son, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. I'm going to tell you something. That adoption means that we begin to follow and we become like our dad. We become like God. A lot of us are woefully short of that. I looked at this and I said, oh God, help me. Because in verse 17 it says this, it goes on to say this through 21. And if you call on the Father who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourself throughout the time of your stay here in fear. And that word fear means awe, the awesomeness of God. Conduct myself throughout my time here in the awesomeness of God, in the presence of God, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your aimless conduct received by the traditions of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ. As a lamb without blemish and without spot, He was indeed foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through Him believe in God, who raised Him from the dead and gave Him glory, so that your faith and your hope are in God. I begin to look at that. And even myself, the Lord started dealing with me about one thing that's not preached in the church today. You know what it is? The blood of Christ. The blood of Christ who cleanses us from all sin. The sacrifice that He made. Verse 17, it says, conduct yourself or walk. So first we listen. Secondly, we walk. Peter indicated that a proper reverence for God and an appreciation for the high cost of redemption demands holy living. We need to understand that Jesus wants to do something powerful and relevant within our life. And what he wants to do is he needs us to understand the high price that he paid for our salvation. We need to understand redemption as the freeing of a slave by paying a price. You are free from being a slave to sin. You are free from the attitudes of the world. You're not bound by them anymore. The payment that released Christians from an empty way of life was the blood of Christ. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. The transforming blood of Jesus that was sacrificed for you and I. We have pictures in the church, and there's one over in the side of the sanctuary about Jesus being nailed to the cross. You know, that picture doesn't do it justice. Jesus was beaten beyond recognition. He bled in places that we don't even and can't even recognize. Jesus was a bloody mess. And the reason why he was a bloody mess was because he knew that he was being the sacrifice for our sins. And his blood was covering our sins. See, Peter also notes that God had determined the performance of the work, or this work, the work of the blood of Christ before the beginning of time. I don't know if I were God, if I would have created this world, had I known that I would have to give my son and sacrifice my son for it a second time. How many of you would have done it? It's a marvelous story. But Jesus, or God in his love, he says, I'm going to create this world. And then he says, I know what's going to happen. Sin's going to creep in. And I know as I create this world, I'm going to have to send my son and have him die to redeem this world back to myself. Folks, how many of you would do that? There'd be very few. Very few. Jesus in Peter's time had only made his plan evident in just a short period. And the first one is in the incarnation. The incarnation. Jesus is God coming in the flesh. Peter walked with Jesus for 3 years. Jesus had a major effect on his life, and he still blew it. But you know what? There is redemption in the blood. If you walk with Jesus and you've had an attitude and a life that's been full, but you would look at it and you would say, I failed. Jesus says, so what? There's still redemption in my blood. I mean, if he can forgive Peter for denying him 3 times, he can forgive you. His passion. His passion. What was the passion of Jesus? What was that? The passion of Jesus. His full attitude. his passion. There was a movie that came out a couple years ago called The Passion of Christ. His sacrifice. He loved us so much that he gave himself for us. How many of you would give yourself for your friends and your strangers? See, it's easy to say, yeah, I would give myself for my family. It's easy to say, I would give myself for my children, my husband or my wife. But how many of you would give yourself for your friends? The sacrifice. When I went to see that movie, The Passion of Christ, I was just amazed. Not only during the movie, but I was amazed as I walked out the theater and the silence, the stunned silence of people as they walked out of the movie, as they got the reality check of the sacrifice of Christ. It's an amazing thing, his passion. And thirdly, the resurrection of Jesus. The resurrection of Jesus. He gave his life so that we might have life. See, ignorance of the presence of God can no longer be an excuse. We can no longer straddle the fence spiritually. We're going to have to make a choice. We're getting into the attitude right now, and it's coming soon, where we're going to have to make a choice for God or for the world. I mean, it's becoming more distinct every day. I want to make a choice for Jesus. And as I looked at that, it can not only no longer be an excuse, but we need to flee from the lusts that destroy our spiritual life. I'm having a hard time dealing with a few things right now. You want to know what they are? I can tell you in a general sense. I'm not going to tell you what they are. There are some things that I really like and I really, really enjoy, and I have enjoyed all my life. And they have been a staple for all my life. And now the Lord is confronting me on some of those things and saying, are you going to take that road or are you going to take my road? And you all will have the same thing in your life. Which road are you going to take? What I ended with last week, it's your choice. It's your choice. God wants to take you down a road of holiness. See, the transformation happens when we understand the holiness of God. He's holy. He's awesome. He's wonderful. He's loving. He's great. He's powerful. He's merciful. He's our salvation. He's our healer. He's our baptizer in the Holy Spirit. And he's our soon coming King. Can we make that real? See, Peter explained the character of God and the high cost of redemption. And they were simply this. They were incentives to produce holiness in you and I. God has given us incentives. You want to be blessed? Bless him. You want to be cursed? Curse him or curse your brother and sister. When people curse you, pray for them and love them anyway. When people stab you in the back, pray for them and love them anyway. These are hard things, and these are things that I'm even going through. When people do things just to get your goat, pray for them. And it's one area that the Lord is dealing with me. I'm going to tell you something. I like to pick on people. You know, I'm an EOP, equal opportunity picker. I pick on everybody. You know? And the Lord said, wait a minute. Are you wounding their spirit by picking on them? Why don't you give them a word of encouragement? And I say, but Lord, that's so hard. I've developed this habit. And that's what it is. It's a habit. And what that habit becomes is a lust. And I need to, instead of pick on people, encourage people. And I'm working on it, folks. I'm not gonna stand up here and tell you I've got it all handled, because sometimes that comes out in my life. But I need to learn how to be an encourager. Their incentives to produce holiness in you and I. He also demanded that holiness show itself in earnest love for other believers and in forsaking all malice attitudes. See? Attitudes. How many of you have ever said about something they've copped an attitude today? Or they've copped an attitude in their life? Sometimes we cop the wrong attitudes. We need to have the attitude of Jesus. Peter urged his readers to express their holiness by genuine love for one another. Love one another. Love one another. A new commandment I give you unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. 1 Peter chapter 1, 22 and 23. Since you have purified your soul in obeying the truth through the Spirit and sincere love for the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, and having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. 1 Peter chapter 1 goes on in verses 24 and 25, saying, because all flesh is of grass. And by the way, this is a quotation from Isaiah 40. All flesh is of as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of a grass. The grass withers, and its flower falls away. But the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word by which the gospel was preached to you. I tell you one thing. I would hope, should we ever depart from one another, the one thing that you would keep within you is the word of God that I've imparted to you. Show that the experience of this love came from a creative activity of God. God's creating something in you. We sing a song, and I almost had it on the list for this morning, but I didn't. Create in me a clean heart, and renew a right spirit in with me. Cast me not away from thy presence. Lord, right now, create in us a clean heart. Renew a right spirit in me, in each and every one of us, so that we might not be cast away from your presence. If you ever come into a dry time, I'm going to say this because it's a very hard thing, but it's the truth. If you ever come into a dry time spiritually in your life, ask the Lord two questions. The first question to ask him is, Lord, will you create in me a clean heart? Will you do something here? Is my heart impure in some way? Or will you renew a right spirit within me? Has my spirit become not right within you? Ask yourself those questions before you go blaming other people and stuff. See, the problem may not be other people. The problem may be me. That's what the Lord showed me, and I didn't like it. Have you ever looked in a mirror and not liked the person that you see? Because your attitude was that bad, and I'm not talking about physical appearance. I'm talking about in the spiritual appearance of your heart. Lord, I don't like it. I'm not right with you here. I'm not right with you. Lord, create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit in me. And the reason why I am not walking in your presence is because one of those two things might be wrong. You following what I'm saying here? Show that the experience of his love comes from the creative activity of God. Let Jesus be active. The Word of God is active. It's alive and it's active. Let it be in your life. Sometimes we think we're fighting off the devil, and what we're actually fighting off is the Spirit of God, because we don't want it to penetrate our hearts and deal with our things that where we're wrong. I mean, you know what I'm saying. That's a tough thing to say, but it's true. Peter directed us to put aside malice and hypocrisy in our response to God's holiness. Put it away. Put away the malice. Put away the hypocrisy. Come before his presence with thanksgiving. Enter into his courts with praise. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house than thousands elsewhere. I want to end with a scripture and then one statement. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Listen to me. A lot of you out there, I know, are spiritually capable of eating meat. Spiritually. You understand what I'm saying? But sometimes we got to go back to the milk. Sometimes we got to go back to the milk. And the reason why we got to go back to the milk is because we have developed something that causes within our spirit an inability to digest the meat. And we have to go back to the milk to reaffirm and clear up that which is unholy and unrighteous so that we can again begin to digest meat. You follow what I'm saying here? This is very important. If indeed you have tasted the Lord is gracious. He's gracious. And I want to end with this little comment. He also encouraged them to grow as believers by appropriating the nurture inherent in the gospel message. I've made a decision recently, the Lord's dealing with me on it, to simplify my messages. Now that doesn't mean they're going to be any less valuable, but I need to simplify them for a while. In that we need to go back and we need to understand where we came from. We need to understand our heritage. The reason why I made that decision, I was listening to one of our pastors, and he said, we forgot our heritage. And he equated that with the Church of Philadelphia, who had forgotten their first love. Listen to me, church. Yeah, the messages are going to be complex, but there's going to be a simplicity to them that says simply this: let's not forget our first love. There's a simplification. Cast me not away from thy presence. Renew a right spirit within me. Lord, help me to understand your grace, your love, your glory, and your simplicity. In that, I simply mean this. Lord, I lift you up, and I say to you, forgive me of my sins. As I end this morning, I want to challenge you to do something with me. You who are here in the house this morning, you who are by video, I want you to pray this prayer with me. And don't pray it unless you're serious. You ready? Father, forgive me. Understand, I have shortcomings, and there are areas where I failed you. But I stand before you this morning, and I ask you to forgive me. And I ask, Lord, that your presence would begin to dwell in me. Lord, let your presence dwell in each and every one of us. Forgive us, O Lord. Forgive us, O Lord. Cause us to be what we need to be in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You prayed that prayer for the first time? Send me a note. Let me know. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. Know that I am praying for you. If I know that you're listening, I'm praying. I recently was just overwhelmed in the spirit because the Facebook account of the church, I knew of several people that have watched, but I was amazed. I said, who in Pennsylvania is watching this? I didn't know. But I'm going to tell you something. I've been praying for you, Pennsylvania, whoever you are. And I want you to know that Jesus loves you and he cares for you. And I want to encourage you to go out and step out in faith and understand that his presence will go with you. And I've been praying that the presence of the Holy Spirit would come all over you and God would bring a revival into your heart and into your life like you've never seen. I don't know who you are, but I know God does. And understand, the presence of the Lord rests upon you. That doesn't mean that that's absent of anybody else that's listening, because the presence of the Lord will rest upon you. Let him come down. Let him minister. Let him touch your heart. Be encouraged. For Jesus is alive and he is well. Amen. God bless you and keep you. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this time together. Dismiss us with your blessing. Let us go humble before your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. God bless you. Ready?